Today, we would be learning about transportation and receipts. I am Chef Aditya Saxena from Chitkara School of Hospitality. So whenever we talk about transportation and receipts in context of hotels and restaurants, we always think of the hazards that possess during the transportation of a food product or while receiving or sending it out. So there are a few certain hazards that we will be covering here. First would be a physical hazard, then it would be a chemical hazard, then biological hazard, then handling of food during transportation, and then receipts and receiving procedure. Now, whenever we talk about transportation of food, it presents three types of hazards. The first is physical hazard, the second one is chemical hazard, and the third one is a biological hazard. Now, if we talk about the physical hazard, now physical hazards such as piece of metal, wood, glass, any other foreign body which may find their way into food while being transported will come under the heading of physical hazard. Any solid body which somehow been, find its way inside the food would be a physical hazard that can contaminate the food. The next one is a chemical hazard. Now, chemical hazard can happen through different, ways. The first one is previous non-food cargoes. Supposedly, a food has been transported in a container which was used for a non-food cargo previously and was not thoroughly cleaned and sanitized. Suppose a piece of a plastic bag or a piece of plastic that finds way inside the food, or supposedly a chemical leakage inside the chamber that find its way inside the food that cause a chemical hazard. Non-food cargoes mixed in the same load. Again, those cargoes which are not food grade cargoes which are mixed with the food that can contaminate. Generally, fumes generated by non-food cargo can mix with the food can hamper the quality of food. Then refrigerant leakage. Refrigerant leakage could be the gas in the refrigerant which could be leaked by a leakage in a cooling pipe that can mix with the food and can contaminate it. Again, it is a sort of chemical hazard. Then residues of cleaning agent. That is a big threat. Whenever we work on a surface in a hotel, we tend to clean it and sanitize it. So what is the sanitization process? First, you have to clean it with soap. Then you have to wash it, then you have to rub it dry, then you have to apply the sanitizer, and then you have to let it dry it out by its own self. Let that surface be disinfect for at least 20 minutes. And supposedly, an XYZ chef has sprayed a disinfectant and he starts using that surface instantly. A disinfectant is itself a chemical. That chemical is meant to disinfect the surface. It's not meant to disinfect the food. Whenever the chemical will mix with food, it will be a hazard for food. Food can be contaminated by either it is a disinfectant or any other chemical. In this case, it is a disinfectant residue of cleaning agent that can also infect or that can be a hazard for the food. So again, this thing also comes under a chemical hazard. Then there would be external environment. Again, if there would be any kind of fumigation that is happening in external environment, though the fumes of those chemical can mix with the food and can contaminate it. Again, that would be a chemical hazard. Then we have got biological hazard. Contamination by bacteria, molds, yeast, parasite, algae, then they all cause biological hazard. Then the growth of biological contaminants if the temperature control is inadequate. Again, the temperature zone, the good temperature zone where food can be kept for a long time is from 1 degree till 3 to 5 degree or 4 degree. From 5 degree till 60, 65 degree is a danger zone, and above 65 is it again a safe zone. If the food is kept for a long time between 5 to 65 degree, again is a danger zone. There could be growth of bacteria, growth of molds, which can cause a biological hazard in food, as the food is contaminated because of mishandling or time and temperature abuse. Again, if the food is being transported or is it put inside a container which is not thoroughly washed, and you could see there could be a molds or algae over there, again food is mixed with that, then again that comes under biological hazard, as food would be not fit for consumption. Next is handling of food during transportation. So the first point is, food transporters should follow the safety and hygiene practices applied during all stages of food transportation. That means regular checking of temperature. If it is a HVAC van, then you have to check the temperature at each and every given time frame. The second is, food should be transported by transportation units which are approved by the food control section. Again, those transportation units which have been approved by the governing authority, the food should be transported only in those transportation chambers. The third is, the food transportation unit shall be chilled for the chilled food product, that is 1 to 4 degrees Celsius. The food transportation unit shall be frozen for the frozen food products, that is minus 18 degree or less. Now, minus 18 degree or less means it should be between minus 1 till minus 18. If the temperature is more than minus 18, there are chances of food getting freeze burn. The next point is, the transportation unit shall be inspected, cleaned or disinfected daily and must be pre-cooled before loading to verify the efficiency of the cooling unit. It is self-explanatory that the food chamber or the transportation unit should be cleaned, it should be inspected, it should be disinfected so there are no biological hazards, and again it should be chilled or pre-cooled so that you could see the efficiency of the cooling unit. It's working properly or not. Next is, the food transportation unit shall be capable of keeping the transported food within the required temperature throughout the transportation period. Supposedly the food is being transported from point A to point B, which had a distance gap of 100 kilometers. So the food should be kept chilled or as per the required temperature throughout those 100 kilometers. It shouldn't fluctuate. If the food is meant to be, chilled, it should remain between 1 to 4 degrees Celsius throughout that 100 kilometer of distance that has been covered. It should not go over 4, or sometimes it should not go under 1. It should be stable between 1 and 4. The last point is, the food transportation unit shall be designed in such a way that prevent cross-contamination. Again, a problematic thing. If the food transportation unit is not designed in such a way, then the food can get cross-contaminated. And how will food become cross-contaminated? Supposedly food A mixed with food B during transportation, again it can be a cross-contamination. Or some piece of wood or metal or anything, or food is being getting in contact with the iron racks on which it is in place, again that would be a sort of cross-contamination. So it should be designed, the unit should be designed in such a way that the food should not be cross-contaminated. The next point is receipts. Now this supplement provides guidelines governing receipts of good purchased by purchasing department. Now purchase department is the department which look after for each and every purchase. Now the receiving procedure consists of the three steps. First is receiving, second is inspecting, third is acceptance. Now the receiving procedure, receiving is the act of taking possession of products in order to sell them for inspection, place them into inventory or deploy them to end use for immediate use. Now whenever we receive food products, either the first thing is we take possession of them, physical possession. We inspect them if it is up to our quality, if it is up to our standard purchase specification, we'll keep it. If it is not, we'll return it. When we keep it, we'll keep it in our inventory, either in a chiller, blast chiller or deep freezer, or we will directly send it to the concerned department, concerned outlet for their consumption. The second point is inspecting. When we will take receiving, we take a physical possession of that product, we inspect it. Now, inspecting means the act of examining products that have been delivered to determine conformance to the purchase specification. Now, we have specified, if you remember, we have specified sirloin steak. It should be from UK, it should be, the weight should be 170 grams plus minus 10 grams. We'll inspect all those things as per our specification. If it is fully confirmed that the food and the product is as per our specification, we'll take possession of it. Otherwise, if it is not, then we'll return it. The third one is acceptance. It means acknowledging that the product and or goods conform to the requirements of purchase order so that the supplier may be paid. Shipments are considered accepted if the customer acknowledges receipt to accounts payable. Now that means when we have inspected the food product, it is as per our specification, we'll acknowledge that yes, the food is as per our inspecting guidelines, as per our specifications, and we accept the delivery that you have given. And then the purchase department will sign the receiving document and will forward it to the accounts department for further payments to be released for the supplier. Now, the acceptance would be acknowledges receipt to accounts payable and do not have a quality or delivery issue. Most shipments are considered accepted and approved for payment by the recipient. The recipient would be the one who approves and pays for the shipments. In hotels and restaurant case, it is the accounts department which deals in the payments and acceptance of the food. So these are the receiving procedures. First is receiving, second is inspecting, and third is acceptance. That's it for the day. I hope you have enjoyed the class. Please stay tuned for the more videos. Till then, thank you.